ओम ज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकाया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमः ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्त स्वामी इति नामिने। नमस्ते सरस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे रामा राम रामा हरे 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 कृष्णा। So today, I'll discuss on a somewhat challenging or also a difficult topic. It is a topic of, does the existence of hell imply that God is cruel? For the last few years, I have been spending a lot of time in the Western world, and in America, I almost spent 6 months, and of course, not in this year. Before that. And so recently, one upcoming devotee asked me this question that they read the fifth canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam and the description of hell over there. They felt this was horrible. So, how can God be so cruel? This is a question I have encountered on many occasions and I've given different answers. But today, I thought we will talk about this topic in a systematic way because this is something which comes in the Bhagavatam explicitly in the fifth canto, also in the third canto to some third canto to some extent, and there are references to it throughout our literature. So I'll talk broadly in three parts. Why, firstly, why hell seems incompatible with a loving God. Then this will be the major part of our class, how Abrahamic and Vedic conceptions of hell differ. And lastly, I'll talk about how we can focus on the positive, not the negative, when we are practicing and sharing Krishna Bhakti. So let's look at these three points. So there is a thought within modern people that even if somebody is a religious believer, there is a book written by a Christian theologian, To Hell with Hell. What he means is that the idea of hell is unacceptable. Why is that? Even religious people can't accept that a loving God would do to his children what we wouldn't approve our police do to criminals or our army do to our enemies. So, for example, the kind of sufferings that are described in hell, they are horrible. So, how could any loving God do something like this to his children? And then, if somebody did like that, how would we consider him loving? As it is said that, as mentioned, that nowadays increasingly, especially in the Western and Westernized world, torture as a means for gaining information is being increasingly disapproved. So even if somebody is a criminal, somebody is a terrorist, if they have given some confession under duress, under force, then that is not considered acceptable in the court of law. So torture in general may be used as a strategy, but it is not an approved thing. So, what to speak of now? If you consider hell, it seems to be like a huge torture chamber. And how could God put somebody in a torture chamber like that? So, many people, so this Christian theologian, he said that actually, yes, God is real, but modern thought sees hell as a barbaric imagination of primitive people. Maybe in the past, people were uncivilized, they did this kind of torture, and they believed also that God would do something like this, but this is just a uncivilized imagination of people from the past. So there is this strong antipathy, and we may also get this question if we look at the sufferings described in hell. How is it possible that God may send someone to hell like this for so much suffering? So now I'll move to, this is just the background. The main part of this class will be the table that I'll going to show in this now. Even if you forget everything from this class, just remember some points from this table. That is enough. You will know the essence of the class. So basically, you know, in different traditions, there are some terms that are similar. So there's a term like soul, there's a term like God, there's a term like hell. The terms are similar, but whether all the terms mean the same thing varies. So now, although the word hell in Sanskrit is used as narak and it's translated as hell in English, that word is there. In the Bhagavatam, the way hell is described, and in the Abrahamic religions means Judaism, Christianity, Islam, the way hell is described, there are significant differences. So first difference is that in the Abrahamic religions, the idea is hell is forever. That if you don't believe in God, if you don't surrender to God, if you don't accept God's particular representative of God as your savior in this life, then you're going to go to hell. That they don't accept reincarnation. So then the idea is that, so many of these religions, they accept the idea of soul and eternal life, but they don't accept reincarnation. So this life is all that we have. And if you don't surrender to God, then you're going to go to hell. Now the Bhagavatam does talk about hell, but the Bhagavatam, hell is temporary. Everything in the material world is temporary. So hell is also temporary. The second part is that in the Abrahamic religions, there's a difference. The hell is for non-believers, whereas the Bhagavatam talks about wrongdoers. What is the difference? Non-believer means if you don't believe in this particular conception of God, you're going to go to hell. Whereas the Bhagavatam talks about specific actions that disrupt society, that disrupt social order. If somebody does that, that's when they're going to go to hell. So each of these points I'm going to elaborate, but here I'll just quickly mention it. And then the Abrahamic religions, the idea is God rejects those who don't surrender to him and God sends them to hell. Whereas the Bhagavatam understanding is that God is present as the Paramatma in our hearts and he goes with the soul everywhere. So he goes with the soul even to hell. So God's love is untiring. And then last point is that if hell is forever, then it's just a place of suffering goes on and on and on. It becomes pointless suffering. I'll explain why. But in the Bhagavatam, hell, the whole universe is seen as a university and hell is like a tough classroom. So, you know, this class, I could have based it on the third canto verse or fifth canto verse, but my focus is not so much on specific verses, but on the overall conception of hell. So let's look at these four points one by one now. So duration. So even if somebody has done something wrong and they need to be punished, but if disciplining is needed, if it is forever, then it is just cruel. It doesn't make any sense. If there is no hope for reformation, if there is no hope for improvement, then what is the point of it? So but the Bhagavatam clearly says that hell is temporary. Like everything else in this world, everything is temporary. Even hell is temporary. In the Bhagavatam, let's look at the Bhagavatam later, but if you look at the Ramayana, the Mahabharata, wherever it described that if somebody is going to go to hell, it is primarily because they have done some wrongs because of which they go there. So now what do you mean by non-believers? So now there are broadly various religions, but now even among each religion, there are so many groups. And among the groups of religions, there are further divisions. So for example, Christianity, there is Catholicism and Protestants. Among Protestants, there are almost 55,000 sects. And then, and some of them, they have some minor disagreements. So for example, one of them, the baptism might be done by sprinkling some water on the head. And for somebody else, baptism might be done by dunking them underwater. And one group will believe that if you are not dunked under water, then you are going to go to hell. You are not delivered. So for some minor theological or ritual disagreement, the idea that somebody should be sent to hell forever. So it's almost every religious denomination will believe that those who are not following the denomination, they're going to go to hell. So this seems outrageous. It seems completely unreasonable. In contrast, if you look at the broad Vedic system, the Vedic system idea is that if somebody does wrongs, just like in an ordinary society, if somebody does crime, then there are various levels of punishment. If somebody does severe crimes, then they are not only sent into confinement, they might be sent to solitary confinement. So there can be increasing degrees of punishments. So the Bhagavatam talks about not so much the sufferings are not for non-believers. We see in the Vedic tradition that different people may believe different things. So if you look at the Mahabharata war, on both sides, the Kaurava side and the Pandava side, there were people who believed different things. On the Kaurava side, there was Bhishma, who was a Vaishnava. Now, of course, there are esoteric reasons why Bhishma had to fight on the Kaurava side. But there were Shantanu, who was also a Vaishnava. There was Bhurishrava, who was a Vaishnava. On the Kaurava side, all this. So they were devotees. But if they fought on the wrong side, Krishna said they have to be punished. On the Pandava side, there was Drupada. Drupada was largely considered to be a Shaivite. Mm-hmm. So he was there and he was fighting. So the fight was not based on religious beliefs. The fight was based on, we could say in today's parlance, maintaining law and order. The Kauravas were such people that they were ready to burn somebody alive. They were ready to burn the Pandavas alive. They had tried to poison Bhima. They had tried to disrobe and dishonor Draupadi. So each of these was serious wrong. And if they were, as kings, were ready to do it to other kings, then what would they be ready to do to their ordinary citizens if they had no fear of retribution from anyone? If Duryodhana had got unchallenged power, then he could have wreaked havoc in society. So the war was fought not because the Kauravas believed in the wrong god. The war was fought because the Kauravas were doing wrong actions. Horribly wrong actions. So similarly, the point I'm making is that in the principle of karma is based on actions, not so much on beliefs. Now we can say beliefs lead to actions. That is true. So if somebody has all kinds of terribly wrong ideas, they will lead to wrong actions. But the punishment is not for the beliefs. The punishment is for the actions. So we see that there were many different people. There were in the Bhagavatam itself, which is very clearly a book centered on bhakti, the Bhagavatam talks about Shamik Rishi, who was an impersonalist. Now we could say he was believing something wrong, that God is impersonal, not personal. Well, it's not wrong. We can say it's incorrect. But he's considered a sage and he's respected for being a sage. So the overall point here is that in the Bhagavatam, the idea is that if somebody does wrong, just like if a criminal does something wrong, there has to be some consequence. So similarly, there is punishment for wrongdoings, not for being a disbeliever. So why is it such a big difference? Because disbeliever means what? Say, for example, somebody might be a very good person, but if they don't believe in a particular manifestation of God, his servant or his son or whoever, then they are going to go to hell forever. So this seems as if God has a personal agenda against people. If you don't worship me, then I am going to make your life hellish. This makes God seem very cruel. That what kind of God would do something like that? But that is not the Bhagavatam's understanding. And this is one of the critical points, that God never forsakes. Now, another point to understand here is from the Bhagavatam's perspective or even from the Bhakti tradition's perspective, God doesn't send us to hell. It is our own mind and our own karma does. What does it mean? The world is governed by certain laws. Say, for example, now I have this phone. Now, if I drop this phone, the phone will fall. And if it falls on the ground, it may crack. Now, if it cracks, it can cause a loss to me. A loss of Lakshmi, loss of information, loss of convenience. So now, if instead of a phone, you say, if I fall down, now if somebody is careless and they are on the terrace of a building and they peer over and they fall down. So if somebody falls down from the, say, fifth floor of a building, they might get paralyzed, they might get brain hemorrhage, and they might go into coma. Now, is God causing that? No. It is a law of gravity. So a person is careless. If a person is careless, they suffer. So there are laws governing the material world, just like the law of gravity is one law. So if somebody breaks that law, then they break themselves by trying to break that law. If I try to step off a 10-story building, now it's not God who breaks my bones. It is I who broke my bones by my own actions. So it is not, so when, so just as stepping off a 10-story building has consequences because I am disrespecting the law of gravity, similarly, there are different laws of karma. And if somebody violates those laws of karma, that according to the nature by which the material world is administered, that has consequences. So it is not that God is causing that suffering. Just like we humans are meant to eat nutritious food, fruits or vegetables or grains. If somebody starts eating glass, now if they eat glass and their tongue starts bleeding and their stomach gets cut and they have terrible pain, now is God causing that pain? No. It is they themselves who are causing the pain. So similarly, so now for in each of these cases, for example, somebody eats glass or somebody steps off a 5-story or 10-story building, we can see that the consequences are coming immediately. But in some cases, consequences may come a little later. Say, if somebody starts smoking at the age of 15 and at the age of 35, they get lung cancer. The consequences might come after 20 years. But it is not God gave them lung cancer. It is not God caused the lung cancer. It is their smoking that led to the lung cancer. So the point is that it is not God who sends us to hell. If somebody has to at all go to hell, they go to hell because of their own karma. And why do they do that karma? Because their mind is deluded. So because of their mind, they do the bad karma, and because of that bad karma, they go to hell. So it's our mind that is responsible. And the key thing is, God goes to hell with us. So he goes to hell with us means he's there with us in our hearts, wherever we go. He says that Ishvara Sarva Bhutanam Hriddeshe Arjuna Tishtati Brahmayan Sarva Bhutani Yantra Rudhani Mayaya. So where Brahmayan, wherever the soul wanders, the super soul goes with him. Ishvara Sarva Bhutanam is there everywhere with the soul. Madhruk Prapanna Pashupasha Vimokshanaya Muktaya Bhuri Karunaya Namolayaya. In the prayers of Gajendra, it is said that he is praying to the Lord, "My dear Lord, please save me. I am bound, please liberate me. Madhruk Pashupasha Prapanna Vimokshanaya. Please liberate me." Why liberate me? "Lord, why should I liberate you?" "Because I am bound and you are free." If he sees somebody is bound and tied up, he may say, "Oh, you shouldn't be bound, it's painful." Muktaya. But the Lord may say that, "You are bound by your own karma. Why should I liberate you?" Bhuri Karunaya. "Yes, although I deserve to suffer, you are so compassionate that you will free me from my suffering." And the Lord may say that, "I have tried to help you so long, so many times, but you never listen to me." Then he says, "Alayaya," that you never get tired, O Lord. You are unflinchingly there by my side. You are always there to help me. So that is the untiring love of God, that he's always there with us. And that is the vision of the Bhagavatam. So God doesn't send us to hell. God goes with us to hell. Now, still the question might come up that, okay, if there is suffering, why is the suffering there? So that is an important point to understand. The suffering is sometimes required to teach a lesson. But sometimes, now, if suffering that has no end serves no end. What do I mean by that? The word end can have two meanings. When will this program end? That means conclusion or termination. And to what end are you speaking this? To what end are you doing this? Means for what purpose are you doing it? So serving that has no end serves no end. If serving is meant to teach somebody a lesson, say if in a class a student is very disruptive, Then the teacher may say, get out of the class and stand outside. Well, that's a punishment. Standing outside where everybody is sitting in the class, maybe outside it is hot, outside they have to stand, they can't sit, their legs start getting tired, outside everybody sees, oh, you must be punished, that's why you're outside. That's a punishment. But if the punishment is forever, then the punishment doesn't serve any purpose. How is the student going to learn? So the notion that God will send somebody to hell forever, that makes God seem cruel, because the suffering becomes pointless. So suffering, when it's pointless, then it becomes unbearable. In fact, if somebody inflicts pointless suffering on somebody else, that is the indication of cruelty. In fact, that is the very definition of evil. To cause suffering simply for the sake of causing suffering, that is the essence of evil. See, in this world, suffering may be caused accidentally. When we are walking along a road and we step on somebody's foot, that is suffering. That's accidental suffering. Sometimes suffering may be caused intentionally, but for a purpose. Just like, say, a doctor gives an injection to a child. The child may feel it very painful, but that pain has a purpose. Surgery involves cutting, which is painful, but that also has a purpose. So if we do a workout, that's also pain when doing the workout, but that pain serves a purpose. So overall, the point which I'm making is, if pain serves a purpose, then it is meaningful, then it is acceptable. But if somebody is causing pain simply for the sake of causing pain, then that is evil. Just like in the scriptures, there's the example of Mrugari. Now, what was Mrugari's characteristic? That he was a hunter, but he was not an ordinary hunter. He was a hunter who delighted in half killing animals and seeing them suffer in pain. So that kind of delighting in other suffering, that is a horrible thing. That is something like evil. So if somebody, if God were to cause suffering forever, then that would make God evil. Suffering that has no end serves no end. Now, then what is the end of suffering? What purpose does suffering serve? So we understand that universe is like a university. Everything that is there in the material world is meant for us to learn a lesson. So hell is like a classroom for difficult students. Now we may say that there's so much suffering in hell. What kind of classroom is that? There's so much suffering that we can't even think of anything, that I'm just going through so much pain. Well, it's not just in hell. Sometimes people get diseases like cancer, and sometimes people go through pain. So there's so much pain, one can't even think of anything else. But the point is, not all pain, not all violence is bad. Causing some pain, if it is meant to communicate in a language that is understood, that is not considered violence. Say, for example, now if somebody is using the horse and the horse is going off in a wrong direction and they pull the reins. Now, if you think about it from the horse perspective, imagine, say, right now I'm sitting and there's a rope tied around my neck and suddenly somebody puts, ah! Now, to have a neck, to have our neck tied in a rope and being pulled suddenly, it's scary. And then to have it pulled repeatedly, pulled in this direction, pulled in that direction, that can seem cruel. But actually, say if somebody is going through a hilly area and the horse is going on a path which will make it fall off the hill, at that time, to pull the horse neck, it will cause the horse pain, but it will save the horse from far greater pain. If the horse topples off the hill and down into the valley, its body will break in 1,000 bones. It will die an extremely painful death. So communicating in a language that is understood, that is not violence. That is communication. It is difficult communication. It is painful communication, but it's communication. So just as in Hindi, they're saying, Lato ke bhoot baato se nahi maante, that some people don't learn lessons. Now, sometimes if you translate these sayings from one language to another, it can be very funny. So if you say, Lato ke bhoot baato se nahi maante, the ghosts of kicks don't learn by words. It makes no sense. But the lesson over there is that if we focus on that sometimes some people have to be taught in a particular way. But the point is not just to beat them, but the point is to teach them. So hell is a place of suffering, but it is meant to teach. And what is the lesson that is to be taught? The lesson is that we need to become spiritually conscious. So this is, in one sense, tough love. Whether it is suffering in hell or elsewhere, it is saves us from perpetual suffering. How does it save us from perpetual suffering? Because if we are in the material world, we forget Krishna and we stay in this distressful material world. So if you consider the world is like a hospital, somebody makes the hospital itself into their home. Well, no, you have your home, you have your life, get out of the hospital. So the world can be compared to a prison, the world can be compared to a hospital. The idea, if somebody is becoming too comfortable in the hospital, then the doctor might make life a little tougher so that the patient feels invigorated to do exercises, take the medicine, recover and get out of the hospital. So for the soul, just to forget Krishna and be in material existence where one goes through the cycle of birth and death, that itself is suffering. To go through old age, disease, death, and then the rebirth, that is enormous suffering. And if the soul becomes spiritually conscious, then the soul is saved from that suffering. So it's tough love in the sense that it is love which is meant to elevate the soul to the spiritual level. Prabhupada writes in an Ishopanishad purport that the miseries of material existence indirectly serve to remind us of our incompatibility with matter. Our incompatibility, that means we are not compatible with matter. We have to focus on the eternal. So for those who are trying to enjoy this world, the various material sufferings are like telling them, go toward Krishna, go toward Krishna, go toward Krishna, go away from here. Like piercing, piercing. We know there is the Durga Devi has the three prongs. So three prongs are Adhyatmik, Adhibhautik, Adhidaivik Kleshas. So by those Kleshas, we are told, go back to Krishna, go back to Krishna, go back to Krishna. So it's tough love. Now a question comes up commonly that how exactly do we learn through suffering? Say, most of us, if we have done something wrong in the past, we don't remember what wrong we had done. So how do we learn from the suffering? If somebody goes to hell, do they remember in hell that, okay, this is what I had done because of which I'm suffering? But there might be so much suffering in hell that they may not even realize it. So how do we learn? This is a significant point to understand. See, we learn through suffering, not through conscious recollection, but subconscious redirection. What does this mean? Conscious recollection and subconscious redirection. Let's look at these two differences, the difference between the two. Say, for example, we use language without knowing exactly when we learned it. So if I ask you right now, the words recollection and redirection, you may know the meaning of these words. But if I ask you, do you remember when you used this word for the first time? Or when we are speaking, we often follow certain rules of grammar, certain ways of pronouncing words. So how do we do that? We may not remember when exactly we learned the word, when we exactly learned that particular grammar rule, when exactly we learned that this is the way it is to be spoken, this is not the way it is to be spoken. But we speak that way. So similarly, when the Bhagavatam speaks about suffering, when we learn from it, it is not necessarily through specific memories. Oh, right now, I'm going through this situation because that's what I did at that time. No, it's more of a subconscious redirection. So we all have certain things which we may do sometimes. But we all have certain things which are unacceptable for us. We can't even think about doing them. Say, suppose somebody makes us angry. We may yell at them. We may even feel like slapping them or punching them in extreme situations. We feel like doing that. We shouldn't do it, of course, but we may feel like doing that. But no matter how angry we get, we may never take up a gun and shoot someone. That is out of question. That is unacceptable. So we all have certain boundaries which we consider are unassailable, which neither can be assailed from outside nor violated from inside. So where do we learn these boundaries? Some of those boundaries we may learn from our upbringing, but many of them are not just from our upbringing. There are two, if you consider a family, there are two children. Maybe both of them are twins. But still, one twin grows up to be a very virtuous person, and the other person grows up to be maybe a person with many, many vices. So why does this happen? So both of them had a similar upbringing, and we may say that both of them had a similar association also to a large extent. But still, the inclinations that they have from within, they are different. Because although the twins are identical physically, they are different as spiritual beings. They are, each of them is an individual. They have done their own karma and come there. So just as we learn language through subconscious redirection, similarly we learn language. Just as we learn language, we learn how to make our choices also. So suffering teaches us through subconscious redirection. Now we wonder, why doesn't suffering teach us directly? Why is there no conscious recollection? There's a reason for that. That there will be simply cognitive overload. Cognitive overload means how much can we think? Say, if I slip and fall down. Now, why did I fall down? I can, at a functional level, say I fell down because the water spilled over there and I walked too fast. That would be, we could say, one level of explanation. But there could be another level of explanation that maybe we have. So for example, if we are doing one thing, two things, three things, whatever we are doing, now for doing each thing, we need a certain amount of intelligence. If that intelligence is lacking, we can't do those things. So we can only, our brains have finite capacities and we can only think about a certain level of things. If you have to think of more than that, we will get overwhelmed. So normally our memory is purpose driven to avoid cognitive malfunction. Say if you are talking with me or if I'm talking with you, if we started remembering everything about a person when interacting with them. So we have had 100 interactions with a person and then we are meeting them again. Maybe it's a close person, a close relative or a close friend. Then we meet them. If we start remembering all the 100 times we have met in the past, then we won't have any bandwidth left to understand what they are speaking right now, to attend to the present. Similarly, if we start getting recollection of all the things that we have done in the past, so if I slip and fall down and I start remembering my previous lives and in which previous life I had done what because of which I slipped, then to what extent do we get that recollection? When the slipping is minor, but if I get some major disease, then maybe I should get some reaction for that. Maybe I should get some recollection of what I did to get that reaction. So it's very difficult. We will become overloaded and we will not be able to function. That's why nature doesn't give us conscious recollection. But what does nature give us? Nature gives us one eternal thing. So Prabhupada was asked this question, is hell eternal, by Haiguru Prabhu? And Prabhupada replied, no. Nothing except Krishna and his ecstatic service is eternal. Krishna is eternal and his abode is eternal. And we can eternally go back to that abode. That is Krishna's great mercy. And now last point I'll talk. So in some traditions, I was once traveling in a train, maybe 10, 12 years ago. And there was a Christian preacher who was traveling and he was talking with people next to him. And the first thing he started is, do you know where you will go after death? And they're a little taken aback. If a strange person asks us that question, we will be surprised. And he said, you are going to go to hell unless you read this book. So now this is a very negative way of trying to present God's message. So it is true that fear has its utility. The fear of God is one of the greatest civilizing forces in human history. It is fear of God which keeps people on the right path. Mad bhayad vati vatoyam suryastapati mad bhayad. Indras dhati. So the wind moves because of fear of me. The rain falls because of fear of me. All this is actually there in the Bhagavatam. And this fear is not in the sense of terror. This fear in the sense that, okay, I don't want to do wrong because there will be disruption, there will be consequences of that. So fear of God is an important civilizing force in human history. It stops people from doing wrong things. How? Because if some people think that I'll get away by doing this, then if they remember God is there and God is watching, and I can't get away from this. But there was a prominent atheist, Voltaire. So he said, Voltaire, Bertrand Russell, both of them had similar mentalities to some extent. So when they would have some get together at their homes, where they would all come together in a room and have something to eat, have something to enjoy, and then close the doors. So why? Because this atheist, he was going to talk about atheism with his friends, with his other elite or intellectual friends, but he didn't want his servants to remember, to know that there's no God. Because he felt if they stop believing in God, then they will do all kind of wrong things. And that he didn't want. Then lastly, so fear of God is one of the civilizing forces. In today's world, we can use it occasionally, but not regularly. Why not? Because we need a more positive motivator. Today, fear-driven outreach, it just alienates people. Although the Bhagavatam talks about hell, Srila Prabhupada hardly ever talked about hell in his classes. He talked about philosophy, he talked about giving spiritual knowledge. How our essential identity is not material, it is spiritual. So we are spiritual beings, and for us, our well-being is in the supreme spiritual being. That's the essence. So the scripture contains many things. There are descriptions of hell and there are so many other things. But what is the core scriptural teaching? That God loves us and that he wants the best for us. Suhridam sarva bhutanam yatva mam shanti mirchati. Krishna is the well-wisher, the benefactor of all living beings. And then he says that if God is the well-wisher of all of us, that means he's always with us no matter what happens. And if we love him back, then we can get the best eternally. So this is the scriptural teaching, the Surudam Sarva Bhutana, Manmana Bhav Mad Bhakto, Madhyaji Mam Namaskuru, Mam Evaishis Yuktonte, Matyane Priyosime. But you are very dear to me, and if you just become devoted to me, you will come back to me. So that is the positive motivation, understanding how much God loves us and how much he wants us to love him back, that inspires us to direct our love towards Krishna. That inspires us ultimately to attain Krishna. So what is the conclusion? The world's power to hurt is great. The world can hurt us in many different ways. People may betray us. We may get some injury. There may be storms and various other things like that. The world's power to hurt us is great. Our mind's power to hurt us is greater still. Why mind's power is greater? Because our mind can make things worse. We might be suffering because of some disease, but if our mind becomes resentful, then that can increase our suffering much more. But greatest is God's power to shield and heal us. And that is the message of the Bhagavatam. See, Parikshit Maharaj was cursed unfairly to die in 7 days. And he could have tried to retaliate, he could have tried to counter the curse, but he did not. The world had hurt him, but he did not let his mind compound the hurt. Instead, he turned towards the Lord, absorbed himself in hearing about the Lord, and thereby he transcended the material world. He attained the spiritual world. So similarly, for each one of us, if you understand that, by studying scripture, if you understand that the greatest power is God's power. For what? Not just power to say lift Govardhanel and other things. Yes, that's important. But here, he can shield us from the world's hurts. He can hear us from the world's hurts, the world's pleasures. And that is the most important message. So if we can learn this message, then we will be always elevated. We'll always be on the path to auspiciousness in our lives. So I'll summarize what I spoke and then we can have some questions. So I spoke today on the topic of is hell, how is hell compatible with God's love? So first I talked about to hell with hell, the idea that people find the conception of a hell utterly unacceptable because they feel how can a loving God do something like this? Hell seems to be like a torture chamber and we don't even want police to subject criminals to that. So how can God subject his loving children, his children to that? Then we discussed about the difference between the conception of hell in the Abrahamic religions and in the Bhagavatam. So four differences. In duration, the hell there is conceived of as eternal, but here the Bhagavatam is described to be temporary. Then the second is that it is not that just because you don't believe in a particular manifestation of a particular of God that you'll have to go to hell. It is only when somebody does some serious wrongs. So it's not for thought crimes that Krishna sends somebody to hell. It is that actually Krishna doesn't send anyone to hell, but when people go to hell, it's like a person who's doing serious crimes is put into jail. Similarly, souls who are very disruptive, they are sent to hell. And third, we discussed that it is not that God sends people to hell, rather their karma sends them to hell and God goes with them. So the material world functions according to laws, and those who break the laws, they break themselves against the laws. Somebody steps off a 10-story building and falls. It is not God who caused their leg fracture, it is they themselves caused it. So the effects of some laws may be delayed in being manifest, but still it is those laws acting, not that God is inflicting that suffering. And then lastly, we discussed how suffering has a purpose. If suffering is forever, if suffering has no end, then it serves no end. If it doesn't terminate, then it doesn't teach anything. So, but when the Vedic understanding, suffering is, because it's temporary, it's like a classroom. And somebody might be sent out of a classroom, or some students might be in a tough classroom where they have a lot of hard work, but it's tough love. So it's not cruelty, it's just what is required for reformation. But why so much pain? Well, pain also teaches at times. Pain sometimes may be the only language in which some communication can happen. Just like a horse, if you just tell a horse, don't go there, don't go there, it may not learn. You have to pull the reins. Then it will not go in that direction. So although there is some pain, that pain is not cruel, that pain is necessary to communicate. So similarly, for some souls, pain is necessary for them to communicate. And then we discuss that even amid that pain, how do we learn if we don't remember what caused that pain? It's not so much to conscious recollection as subconscious redirection. It's like we learn to learn language. We use language without knowing exactly when we learned which words and which grammar rules. So why don't we have conscious recollection? Because we will have cognitive overload. Every single thing that happens, if you start remembering, why did this happen to me? In which lifetime did I do what? You won't be able to function in this lifetime. And then lastly, I talked about Krishna. Sorry, not sorry, lastly, last in the four comparisons, the Krishna doesn't send us to hell. Krishna goes with us to hell. Krishna never forsakes. And then I talked about we don't focus so much on hell. Prabhupada, although they described in the Bhagavatam the concept, the topic of hell, but that was never the thrust of his preaching. Because while fear of God can be a civilizing force, in today's world, fear of God can seem simply like a threat to people. So Prabhupada focused on giving knowledge that we are spiritual beings and that God loves us. So if God loves us and we love him back, therein is our greatest auspiciousness. And we concluded by three points that first is that the world's power to hurt us is great. Our mind's power to hurt is greater still. But greatest is God's power to shield us from both the world's hurt and our mind's hurt. And it is that Krishna who is available to us in the Bhagavad Gita, through the practices of Bhakti Yoga, and by the mercy of Srila Prabhupada. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So there are some questions. Should I answer these, or Balwant Prabhu, you want to choose the questions?
Yeah, Hare Krishna Prabhu. I will actually choose, because there are a lot of questions which has come privately also to me.
Sure, please.
So if it's okay, then I will speak, and then probably you can take it from the main chat windows also.
Sure.
So yeah, so first question, Prabhuji, is that why Krishna created hell, or why does the hell exist when we have hellish kind of experience here itself?
Yes, that's a good question. So when there are hellish kind of experiences here, why is hell required? Yes, sufferings can come in different ways, in different situations. And just as pleasures, there is variety in pleasure, there is variety in suffering also. So in this world, there is suffering, but there is also pleasure in this world. So some people by their past karma may have more suffering than pleasure in their lives. And some people may have more pleasure than suffering. But we could say hell is a place where there is concentrated suffering. Yes, there can be hellish suffering. If somebody gets like terrible terminal cancer and without pain medication, they would be screaming constantly. That's hellish suffering. Somebody was in a concentration, people were in a concentration camp. Their suffering was hellish. So yes, that is evidence that you don't even, that even we human beings can be so evil that we can create hell for each other. Or nature can do that for us. So basically different kinds of karma can lead to different kinds of sufferings. So some sufferings in hell are giving reactions to certain kind of karma. Some sufferings here give reactions to certain kind of karma. But generally here it's a mixture of pleasure and pain. Whereas in hell it's more concentrated suffering. Okay.
Thank you, Prabhuji. My next question is that we suffer in hell due to our karma. And due to the same karma, we suffer in our next life also. So why there are two punishments for the same misdemeanor? How to explain this?
Well, no, that's a common question or common misconception, I would say. It's not that it's the same suffering. See, let's put it this way. Somebody was in a human form and they did some, say, 50 units of good karma, 100 units of bad karma. So now, of course, karma cannot be quantified like this, but just for metaphor's sake. So then out of that 100 units of bad karma, they might get some 30 units of bad karma in hell. So basically, bad karma's reactions can come in three ways. One is lower planets. Second is lower species. And third is lower level here itself. That means greater suffering here itself. So maybe 50 units of that suffering we get in hell. Then somebody might go to a lower species. And that lower species also, there might be suffering. Now, again, in that lower species, there is variety. If somebody is a street dog in India, they might suffer quite a bit. But if somebody is a pet dog in America, they might have a comfortable life. That soul might have a comfortable life there. So again, so even in the animal world, there is suffering. So why do some animals suffer more than others? That's also karma. So that soul had done some karma in the human life, which it got, the reaction for which it got in this life. So that's different. So say maybe units of 50 units are exhausted in the hell. Then maybe 20 units are exhausted in an animal body. And then that soul gets a human body again. And when the soul gets that human body, at that time, the remaining 30 units of karma may come. So if from the karma stockpile, it's not that hell exhausts all of that karma. Some of it is exhausted. And the remaining can come in animal species or in subsequent human form.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Thanks a lot. Thank you. The next question is that which factors, free will, bad association, or prarabdha affect mostly the devotee or the person who is on the path of God realization?
Which factor affects free will? Which factor affects a devotee the most? Free will, prarabdha, or association? See, each of these have their space. Say, let's compare this to an exam to car driving. The kind of car that we have got and the kind of weather or traffic that we will meet when we are driving, that is determined by our prarabdha. So car refers here to the body, and along with our body, by our birth, a certain kind of trajectory for our life is determined. Say if somebody is born in India, their life will go in a particular way. Somebody is born in Africa, their life will go in a particular way. It can be changed, but certain things are fixed. Say if Indians go to America, now a second generation Indian boy might want to behave like an American, might want to be American, but they can't because they have brown skin. They don't have white skin. So there is a whole phenomena called ABCD, American born, confused Deshis. So they just can't be like Americans even they want. So the point I'm making is, our prarabdha determines our body, which is like our car, and some conditions in our life, not everything. Just like if I'm on a particular road, then what kind of traffic, what kind of weather that I'm going to get, that's fixed. Now, what is in my control? How well I drive my car. So that means we could say our prarabdha, which you can also call as destiny. It's not exactly the same, but let's keep prarabdha basically means the karma which you have done is going to come, which is going to come to us in the near future. So, prarabdha refers to the karma which has already come to us, and our prarabdha refers to that is going to come to us. So prarabdha can be, broadly speaking, our car, we could say. Our prarabdha will refer to the weather and the traffic and everything. So our body gives us a certain, our car will determine how we can drive. Say a car can't fly, a car can't go underwater. And depending on the kind of model of the car, it may not be able to go very fast, or it may not go through very small roads, whatever. There are certain limitations which will come with it. But still, whichever car one has, one can always become a better driver with that car. So destiny determines what happens to us. We determine how we respond. And so another way I put it is, there's an article on GitaDilly.com about this, that we are not the masters of our destiny, but we are the makers of our destiny. What is the difference between masters and makers? Masters means we determine completely our destiny. That's not true. You know, tomorrow we might meet with a fracture. Tomorrow we might want to do something, but that may be taken away from us. So we are not the masters. We can't control it completely. But we are the makers. We are the makers means what we do now will shape our destiny in the future. So when, which actions result will come, that is not in our control. So in that sense, we are not masters. But our actions will determine our future sooner or later. And in that sense, we are makers. So now, how well we drive the car, that we could say is determined by two factors. Both our free will and our association. So free will is something which we always have. And the kind of people we associate with right now, that will shape how, what kind of choices we make. So prarabdha will determine certain things which are unchangeable for us. And trying to change them, that may not work even for a devotee. Say like even somebody might become a devotee, but it's not that if they have dark complexion, their complexion is going to become fair. If they are short, it's not that they're going to become tall. If somebody is a devotee, they, if they have an IQ of 110, their IQ is not going to become 160. So there are certain things which may not change. But a devotee's IQ may not increase. IQ refers to intellect, which is information processing ability. But a devotee's intelligence will increase. Intelligence means not information processing ability, but decision-making ability. See, information processing ability is the capacity to remember, the capacity to present, capacity to analyze. That is intellect. So a doctor might have more information than any other person why one should not smoke. But the doctor may be hooked to smoking and not be able to give up smoking. So the doctor has intellect, but the doctor doesn't have intelligence. So our intellect may not increase by our practice of bhakti, but our intelligence will increase. A devotee will be able to take wiser decisions. So both free will. So with whatever free will we have in our situation, say if I have a car which the maximum speed is say 100 kilometers per hour. Somebody else has a car, they are on a road, or they have a car which can go at 150. Well, I can only go at 100, but if I go carefully and I learn driving well, I'll go safely. So we could say our free will is limited by our prarabdha, but it's not completely limited. Within limits, we have free will. And if we use that well, we can create a good future for ourselves, a better future. And if we choose association, especially if we can find like-minded association where we can unburden our hearts, where the other person can also speak candidly with us, then whatever shocks come in our life, that association will also shield us from those shocks, help us bear those shocks and move forward. So I don't think we can make a mathematical tabulation of which factor will affect how much, but there are certain things which are not changeable. So a devotee accepts that, okay, this is my prarabdha, I can't change it, but I still have free will and I still have association. With that, let me do the best that I can within this situation. So for a pure devotee, we can say that it's not prarabdha. But even Prabhupada, with all his purity and all his vigor, he couldn't get success for preaching in India. And that's why after 30, 35 years, he decided to go to America. And there he got good success. And then he came back to India. And then he got a different kind of success there. Indians didn't become devotees, but Indians became great well-wishers at that time. So even for a pure devotee empowered by Krishna, there are certain things which we cannot change. But there are other things which can be changed. And that same principle applies to us also. So as devotees, we use our intelligence to focus our energies, and thereby we can create a better future for ourselves. Okay?
Krishna Prabhuji. Thank you, Prabhu. The next question is that I understand that hell is like a classroom for difficult students. However, my doubt is that while suffering in hell, whether a person will be able to understand their mistakes, think about Krishna while experiencing such terrible pain.
Yeah, see, sometimes we may go through certain situations where we may not realize why we are suffering. That is okay. As I said, there is some things which are learned by conscious recollection and there is subconscious redirection. So it is not necessary at that time for us to remember why we suffered. Now, as far as remembering Krishna per se is concerned, generally it is very difficult to begin remembrance of Krishna anywhere in any body other than the human body. I mean, human or above. The devatas can remember Krishna, but for any body lower than the humans, just like there are animal species. Can animals remember Krishna? Well, it's difficult. They don't have that much evolved consciousness. So if somebody is in, if somebody has, however, if somebody has remembered Krishna in a human form, and then they go down, like say it happened with Bharat Maharaj, that he got attached to a deer, remembered a deer, and that's why he went down. But when he went down, what happened? Because he had practiced bhakti, even in the animal species, he remembered Krishna. So if somebody has remembered Krishna in a human form, then even in non-human form, they will be able to remember Krishna. So similarly, if somehow a devotee, if somebody has practiced some kind of bhakti, they have remembered Krishna in human form, if somehow they have to go to hell, they will remember Krishna there also. But generally, devotees may not have to go to hell because Krishna will redeem the devotee and elevate the devotee from there. So just as we may say, what is the point of suffering in the animal bodies if there is no remembrance of Krishna? No, through that suffering also, there is a gradual education and a reorientation. The similar purpose is served through the suffering in hell also. Okay? Thank you.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Danda Prabhu. Mm-hmm. Next question is, Prabhu, this question asking, do devotees have to go to hell if they commit some accidental sin also?
No, definitely not. In general, devotees will never have to go to hell. But if somebody has done some terribly wrong activity, then maybe. But generally, Krishna will elevate the devotees. Apichet Suduracharo, Bhajate Mamanani Bhak, Sadhur Eva Samantavya, Samyag Vivasito Hisaha. So,
thank you, Prabhu. One more question is that you gave a good example that sometimes suffering or pain is like doctor giving injection and it is for our good. So when we see that our family members or close relatives, and we think that we don't want them to fall in the hellish life, and try to recommend or suggest some regulative principles, is it giving pain for good, or should we deal with them differently?
Okay, that's an important question. If our relatives are doing something which may lead them to severe consequences, should we give them teach them our regulative principles strongly? Well, yes, we can speak about it, but we have to be careful. I'm just sharing one slide over here. I have a whole seminar on this topic, but I'll quickly mention this. See, if this is our situation, this is, I am here, or say, this is a devotee, this is a devotee's relationship with Krishna. This is a devotee's relationship with the family member. And this is their relationship with Krishna. So what we want is, we want them to connect with Krishna, or at least we want them to disconnect from whatever wrongs they are doing. That is good. We want them to grow. But however, we have to have our priorities clear. Sometimes what happens in trying to pressure them to do something, you should do this or you should not do this. Okay, maybe I should. Where is the cursor here? Okay, so anyway, in order to get people to do three, what happens is we pressure them so much that for them to develop their relationship with Krishna, that in that process, our relationship with them gets strained. And when our relationship with them gets strained, what happens is eventually our relationship with Krishna also gets strained. So if you see, if we have a bad quarrel with someone, the first casualty of a quarrel is our next day's chanting. During chanting, we are constantly thinking, oh, this person, why did I speak like this? Why did they speak like that? I'll do like this, they'll do like that. It's very, very difficult to focus. So we can encourage them. We can push them a little bit, but not so much that it strains our relationship with them. So we should, first of all, focus on our relationship with Krishna. And if they also develop a relationship with Krishna, that's wonderful. But if they don't, then keep the three relationships different. Keep this relationship, your relationship with Krishna the first. Then make sure, do what it takes to maintain a good relationship with them. And then after that, if they can develop a relationship with Krishna, that is good. If we put too much pressure on them for doing something in the domain of three, we may damage two and we may damage one, and that will be counterproductive. So yes, if they're doing something wrong and we don't want to stop them from doing it, that is good. But we have to know that everybody has free will and we can't control people. Even Krishna doesn't control people. So Krishna says, na buddhi bhedam janayet ajnanam karma sanginam joshayet sarva karmani vidvanyukta samacharam. That don't disturb people's minds, even if they are attached and even if they're ignorant, but act in such a way that they can be gradually elevated. So that requires some intelligence and expertise how to do that. Okay.
Thank you, Prabhu. Wonderfully explained, Prabhuji. Next question is, how to convince our mind to avoid doing things which we are aware that is going to cause us suffering, but we still do it?
Yeah, so convincing the mind is very difficult, but we can equip our intelligence by providing alternatives. So see, there is, we could say, transformation of the mind, which will take a long time. Say, for example, if some things we have indulged in a long time in the past and we want to give them up now, the mind will still keep liking them. So what happens when the mind has that craving, that desire, at that time when it comes up, just to say no to it is very difficult because it creates a sense of deprivation. So instead of that, we need to provide for ourselves something positive that we can do. If we can provide ourselves that, something positive means that something which we can, something which also gives us pleasure, but it's also good for us. So if we can provide ourselves something like that, then that can help us become elevated. So we provide a healthy alternative to the mind. And as soon as we provide that, then say, for example, the mind wants to enjoy something sensual. So basically underlying that is the need for pleasure. So if we can provide the mind something pleasurable, even if it is different from what the mind wanted. So say, suppose at that time we say that I will chant. Our chanting may not give us pleasure immediately. But if we have something like, maybe we like kirtans, we like shloka recitation. So here I'm showing a diagram. Can you see this? There are things that are good for us. That is many things about bhakti. And there are things we like to do. These are according to our swabhava. So somebody may like to read books. You tell them kirtans, okay, I can do it. Somebody like to do puja. You tell them to read books, okay, not so much enthusiastic. So where these two intersect, things that are good for us and things we like to do, where intersect, that is called a uddipan. That is a spiritual stimulus. So if we can provide ourselves things in this area readily available. So when the mind proposes something, I want to do this. No, do this. You want pleasure? There's pleasure available here also. So that way we can redirect the mind. And gradually by this redirection, the mind will get purified. So we can't expect purification immediately, but we can use our intelligence to create resources for redirection. Does that answer the question?
Thank you, Prabhu. Thanks a lot, Prabhuji. Prabhuji, this Rudy is asking that why was the universe and Jivatma created? If all Jivas were part of Paramatma, why have Jivas come to Dukhalaya? Why Jivas came to Dukhalaya?
Yeah, no, that's a big question. But broadly speaking, we could say two principles. First is the very existence that all of us are meant for love. Krishna wants us to love him, and Krishna wants to love us, and he wants us to love him. And love requires free will. Now, without free will, there can be no love. And free will has no meaning without the domain for executing, exercising the free will. Just like some people say that you are free to express your mind as long as you agree with me. Well, that is not freedom at all, isn't it? So if now these three things, love requires free will. Free will requires an arena to exercise free will. So that arena is the material world. So if there were no material world, then there would be no meaning to free will and there could not be any real love. So the material world is indirectly an expression of God's love for us, by which he gives us facilities to exercise our free will. Now, it is not that God sent us to the material world. It is not, but rather that it is an arena for us to exercise our free will. And now, within this arena, there are two purposes. We could say the world has two purposes, experimentation and redirection. Experimentation is if the soul has a desire that, oh, there are many other things I can enjoy in my life. And okay, then try it out. Experiment with various things. So the world provides us various options for experimenting. And then the world provides us the opportunity for redirecting. So the soul has many options like that. And so the world in that sense has firstly, it is an arena for free will. In that sense, it's the expression of love. And within the world, it provides us facilities for experimentation and redirection. Okay.
We will take one last question and then probably, okay.
Yeah.
And this question is, the devotee is asking that, for example, I'm attached to coffee, but I have redirected that coffee. So I drink now only ISKCON approved coffee, okay. But I'm still attached to coffee. Although I'm still attached to coffee. So I have, although redirected myself, I'm still attached to the taste of coffee. It may still pull me down. So how do I work on that attachment?
Okay. That's a very sincere question. So I am taking, if you are taking only say coffee that doesn't contain caffeine, but still you are attached. See, we in our life, then how can we deal with the attachment that can pull us down still? In our life, we all have to choose our battles. There are certain things which will pull us down in a very serious way. Some things will pull us down in a not such a serious way. Some things can raise us up in a very substantial way. Some things can raise us up in a relatively small way. So we all have limited time, and within the limited time, limited time in the sense that we have limited lifespan, and within our limited lifespan, we have so many other things to do because of our family, professional, social obligations. So the time we have for Krishna Bhakti in a sense is limited. So we need to use it optimally. So it's good to be cautious about any attachment that we have, but it's it's constructive to focus on cultivating positive attachments rather than on giving up negative attachments. Especially, I would say that the attachment to the taste of coffee is not a very seriously damaging attachment. Just like, say, devotees might be like that, we might be attached to so many things. In devotee circles, we might have delicious prasad. Somebody might be attached to gulab jamun or rasgulla or halwa or whatever. Well, those are attachments, but they are not going to be very damaging. And of course, we may say that any attachment can be a problem. Yes, that's true. But what is the cure for it? We don't want to focus too much energy on fighting the negative. The energy has to be focused on connecting with the positive. Yeah. Why connect with the positive? Because when we get a higher taste, the lower taste will naturally go away. It is, so we try to, again, like I said, the Uddipan earlier, find out something which you like to do and which is good for you, something within bhakti, and commit yourself to that. So if you can commit yourself to that, say maybe if you like to hear kirtans or read Bhagavad Gita or hear some classes, so try to do that more. And if we indulge in something worldly more than what we should indulge, then rather than simply beating ourselves up for that, that I should not do that, as a sort of devotional atonement for that, we can plan that I will do that devotional activity more. So then what will happen by that is we are connecting with Krishna more, and the more we connect with Krishna, our attraction to Krishna will strengthen. And as the attraction to Krishna increases, we get a higher taste, then the lower tastes will organically go away. Okay? So thank you very much for your many thoughtful questions.
Hare Krishna. Thank you, Prabhuji. Thanks a lot.